Okay, something different this time. Going to take a visit to a friend of mine, Shaun Reynolds of SeanReynoldsAstro.com. He's a local astrophotographer, award-winning astrophotographer. And we're going... Let's pull it out here. And we're going to go and have a look at some of his images. Shaun uses a Canon 6D. And the Canon 6D has been in production and is now out of production, but first came along in 2012, and it's the camera I use. And as a budget astrophotographer, like most of us are, where we're having to be careful of what we spend, Canon 6D is a good full-frame camera for astrophotography. And you can buy them now second-hand for a fairly achievable price. So rather than looking at my stuff again and again, I thought we'd go and actually speak to someone who sells images produced with a Canon 6D and who has got some really fantastic photographs. And I'm going to put links to his website and everything down in the description. So let's go and have a chat with Shaun Reynolds and see what he produces with his Canon 6D. Turned up, I'm here with Shaun Reynolds, and you can check out his website, SeanReynoldsAstro.com, and there'll be a link on the screen, as you can see right now, and the links are in the description below. So check them out. So Shaun's been using the Canon 6D for a lot longer than I have, so we're going to have a look at some of his shots and see what he does with his, and see how he feels about the Canon 6D in 2019.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, mate?
Alright, yeah. Nice.
So you got your Canon 6D out there. What lens have you got actually on that at the moment?
Okay, yeah, on this one at the moment, which I use quite a lot now, is the Sigma Art lens, 50mm f1.4. It's a brilliant lens for getting up close on the Milky Way and what have you. Because it's a modern lens that copes with the subject really well. Doesn't bloat the stars. I mean, it's such a modern lens that copes and gives a lovely definition right to the edges of the frame.
Yeah.
I think.
So you find that, because it's really sharp, that's what they're really known for, isn't it?
Yes, it is. That's dead sharp. I mean, I've got a 24mm Canon lens, which is phenomenal glass, but because it's old tech, I mean, you find that when you're doing, obviously I do a lot of panoramics, so there's a lot of overlap, but at the edges of the frame, there's a lot of aberrations and bleeds, where the stars bleed out around the edges.
Yeah,
it's just because it's an old sort of technology, really. It doesn't cope brilliantly with the nighttime shots like some more modern ones do.
But you still find it okay to. You don't get like problems when you do a panoramic of where the vignetting is bleeding over into the next image.
No, not at all. No, that's very good. I mean, I it's an f1.4, and I because it lets such a lot of light in. I don't use it at f1.4. I can stop it right down at f2 or f2.8, which eliminates just about any bit of vignetting at all.
Yeah.
The only thing I do is quite a bit of overlap, but that's more to do with the stitching parameters and the bloating around the extreme edges kind of thing.
Yeah. Do you use Photoshop to do your stitching or?
Yeah. Well, sorry, no. I used to take me all night on Photoshop, but because I do quite a lot of them, The last few years, I actually invested in Autopanel, which is like a brilliant bit of software, because you can throw them all in generally and click a button, and then you've got the ability to change certain things and edit things within that program before you bring it out for your post-editing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Autopanel makes your life a little bit easier.
Definitely, yeah. I started out with Photoshop, and I was finding on I used CS4. I couldn't really cope with big panoramics. I think that probably a different story now with a more modern Photoshop. But back then, you'd do two or three, and I couldn't cope with any more, so I had to build them up three at a time.
Yeah.
Bigger sort of panoramics, then stitch them, and so on and so on. But I've heard people talk of Microsoft Ice.
Oh, yeah.
It's supposed to be very good.
I use that. I have to admit, I do find that with Photoshop that anything to do with stars, it struggles to actually stitch the Milky Way together. It just
It can be. It's quite a demanding sort of stitch, isn't it? You know, with the movement and what have you.
Yeah,
but I've heard that Ice does very well. But you know, Autopanel is brilliant for very, because I do some more panoramics, about 40 panel, you know, and it works very well. It just throws them together with no problem at all.
Works with raw images from your camera?
Yes, I always shoot in raw. I never raw plus JPEG. I never even go JPEG. I think I did one the other night with Star Trials, but I won't do it again. You need to keep all that detail that you've originated, that you've got in the camera, because then obviously you can go back and adjust anything that you want.
No loss. Cool. Yeah. And do you use a filter? Do you use a light pollution filter with your camera?
I've tinkered about a little bit with them, but I tend not to. I did have a CLS filter, and I tried it out. But to be honest, I find that the Canon 6D, the Mark 1, is just a brilliant camera on its own. And it lets you enough sort of hydrogen alpha and what have you through in its sensor. That no, I don't. I look for dark skies, but I haven't really tinkered that much with it.
So dark sky is more, you get better at dark sky than using a light pollution filter.
Yeah, I go for, well, a little bit of landscape, obviously, but I'm looking for the sort of darkest and best skies we can find, really, around our area or elsewhere. As I say, I did try it once. I tried the clip filter. And I didn't really explore it too much, because I've got on fine with, going to the dark sites with the camera itself, with the sensor on that.
You say the rewards for finding, I know it's a lot of effort to find dark sites in this country, but the rewards are worth it.
Definitely, yeah. That's no good. That's like if, you've got to go there to get this. I mean, that's what you're taking a picture of, is some of the faintest stuff in the sky, and to make your picture better, you've got to find the right conditions for it. That's like a landscape photographer. It's not going to go out at 1 o'clock in the afternoon on a midsummer's day to get a beautiful sunset. He has to get there at the right time and the right place. So it's exactly the same thing. The better the conditions, the better the shot.
Oh, fantastic. So you've actually got some images you were going to show us.
Yes.
You've taken with it.
Yeah, sure. I got two or three up on here, and they all mean something to me, because they're all significant in different ways, you know.
Yeah.
This one is, well, the most iconic sort of Norfolk's iconic lighthouse, Haysborough Lighthouse.
Yeah. The place that's slowly falling
that,
into the
that
sea.
Is, yeah. So in maybe in 10 or 20 years' time, that'll be worth something. But, I went out there about, well, this must be probably about 4 years ago now, because I do, as you know, I do a lot of deep sky stuff with my telescope in the back garden. And I kind of wanted to get out under the stars and practically, get on and see the sky and try out some wider field stuff. So I tried around here, and I sort of cut my teeth on it. But this was the first shot for me that was a proper panoramic of a decent dark sky. And everything was right. That was in the right time of year, because that's very important, as well as the right area and the right skies, looking for the best skies. Obviously, you've got a great landscape to put in there, but it's also about the timing. You've got to know where the Milky Way is and get the right time of the year and the right time of the night to get it at its darkest. And that happened to be in early April. It's about a month where the Milky Way has risen just over the lighthouse, just before it starts to get light.
Yeah.
So of course it's half past three in the morning, but it's a brilliant dark night. I went out there, literally got the 6D on the tripod, straight out of my car, 14 shot panoramic this was, and that was the first proper go that I was pleased with, and that went well, but I was out there, I was there for about 20-30 minutes and then straight back, and been working on that for quite a bit of time, stitched that with Photoshop, which took about one night, and then the next night also processing it through Photoshop.
Yeah, so there's no stacking or dark frames involved. Those are frames straight out of the camera.
That's right. Yeah, I mean, I do a lot of that. Obviously, as I said, with the deep sky, I do a load of that, and everything's got to be so exact. So I kind of want the freedom of I want to see what I could get with a single exposure. Mm. You know, without any of the messing about with any of that. I just wanted to see what I could get. That's what I did for a long time, and I've only just now started to think about perhaps doing a little bit more, which is with in the way of stacking, but not to a huge degree anyway.
So that
was my first one anyway. That's the other one to show, which that I'd done it about 3 years ago. And I'll put that in because that's just a single, one single exposure of a 20-second. It is, yeah, Dirtle Door in Dorset. And as I started sort of going around this area looking for dark skies, of course, it draws you to find better and better. And I wanted to get the core of the Milky Way, down here. Mm. And the further south and further away from light pollution you can get, the better. But because the core is down at the horizon, we often get so much light pollution inland or looking that way that you're shooting through the atmosphere, so it's a bit murky. So also the landscape is just about as good as you can get. So iconic there. And but because it's looking out to the Southern Ocean, you're looking into an area of no lighting, essentially, no light pollution at all. Just black ocean. So you've got a much better chance of capturing some detail down there. I spent all night there, but this was the very first shot of the night, and I caught a couple of meteors in there and what have you, and this is a single shot, but it's been worked on in Photoshop to bring out the light in the foreground and to keep some detail in the Milky Way.
And you can see the Triffin Lagoon Nebula in there, and
you actually
got quite a good dynamic range on that.
Yes, yes.
What sort of settings did you use for that?
This one, because it was 2 or 3 years ago now, I often shoot at like ISO 3200, which I find is great for doing single shot stuff. And this was the rule of 500, so I think that lens was the 24mm lens, and that gave me about 20 seconds of exposure time. I usually go in at f2 or f2.8, depending on the lens. I think that would have been f2.8 with the 24mm lens, going by memory, and a 20-second shot, which is, you can gather an awful lot of light in that time. But the nice thing is, because you've got Portland-built lighthouse a few miles down the road, just gave enough light to give some detail in the foreground there with a bit of enhancement. I got lucky with some meteors on at the Perseids there. I think that was about the 10th of August when I'd done that year. So it's just ahead of the peak sort of thing.
You've got some nice detail there, and even at f2.8 you got everything in focus. It's got, even with this shallow depth of field, you've got really good focus on everything there, haven't you? There's plenty of detail right in the rock structure, which you must have loved.
Yes, that was because that was a major feature of it, sort of thing. So I had to make sure I had the right kind of, I want to get the right distance and perspective for that reason as well. And I ended up quite a way away on top of a cliff that night doing that.
So you feel it's important to give the foreground subject just as much thought as the Milky Way behind?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I did on this and the early stuff. I mean, especially when in an iconic place like this. I found I did do a panoramic. I didn't need it really in my view. I mean, because it's all that's what it's about. It's about the Dirtle Door. And that rise in Milky Way. So I found a single exposure to do that best, really.
It's gorgeous and popular shot.
Yeah. And there's a lot of people there. It's a very, very popular place. Most places I go are so out of the way that there's no one around. But this place, there's about 30 other photographers about all night. And a lot of them were using torches to light the thing. So I actually waited for my gap to get a picture unlit, basically, because I don't tend to do too much of that sort of light painting, very occasionally, but not generally. something.
So I'm looking at that. What time of the year was about September time?
Yeah, well, that was early August. That was, yeah. I think it was about 9th or 10th of August. So we had, I think the astronomical darkness fell at about 11, quarter past 11 that night. And this was around about half past 11 at night, I think, when I got there. And I seem to recall, because I think I was going to do a time lapse or whatever and some other stuff. But in the end, I that was the shot. But I think I stayed there till about 3 a.m. before it started to get light again. And then came back. But as I say, that was just the very first shot of the night. And that was the best one, really.
Fantastic. And you, what's the other image you had?
Yeah, the other sort of third image, pop that down. Why is one that going on something different, as I was saying to you earlier, about bringing in the idea of stacking the Milky Way and going a little bit further than a single exposure. You may well remember this because you were with me last summer when we had a combine harvester going up and down at Contendwood with massive lights, and we had to wait for them to pass to get the exposure in.
That's the only time I almost believed in UFOs, the way those lights were chasing around us.
Absolutely, close encounters of the third kind it was that night, I think that's. But what we ended up with, I mean, I think it was over two nights because you were with me one night and I went there the following night. But basically, I wanted to get the looking through the Milky Way itself with this 50mm lens, mm-hmm. to give the detail, across the northern sky, if you like. And this is the result was this. This was and it's 8 or 9 panes of a mosaic, but each pane, of course, I used the tracker to counteract the rotation of the Earth, and takes, I think there were 60-second exposures, and I did about 10 on each plane. So there was obviously 10 times 60 seconds, so there's 6 minutes on each one. And there was quite a bit of overlap. But as you can see, I mean, that's the next step for me, I think, to do a bit more detail. Because when you're doing that kind of thing, when you're stacking, obviously that cuts down a lot of noise and gets rid of a lot of that, smooths out the image so much more that you can pull more detail out and still have it smoother. And as you can see, this camera, the Canon, is brilliant at keeping the detail in the nebulosity. So it's quite a sensitive chip and it lets a lot of this nebulosity through, which a lot of cameras don't let so much through. They block that out because of the daytime imagery, that, you know, they're sort of, it would look more pink.
And this is captured with an unmodified camera.
Exactly. It's an unmodified, unfiltered Canon 6D. But as I say, this was 80 or 90 pictures in total that went to make this up.
Yeah.
So it's like 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, so 60 seconds each.
Cassiopeia running all the way to...
Yes, you got from Cassiopeia. Cygnus. Yeah, we're coming across there. Slightly further down from Cassiopeia, you've got the double cluster. And then you're coming across to... IC 1396,
the elephant's trunk. You remember these better than I
do. that's the elephant's trunk. That's the Heart Nebula. That's the elephant's trunk. Then you're coming across, which is lovely in the summer for us. Because right overhead is the mighty constellation of Cygnus, and you've got the wall there. You've got the Pelican Nebula. Yeah. There's so much there.
The North American.
Gamma Cygni there, and of course then you're heading down. Where it's a lot thicker, the dust, you're heading down towards the centre of the galaxy. So, you know, but also you're heading down towards the horizon, which is why I had to sort of finish off there, because you're going through the light pollution. So you start to fade as you get towards the horizon. But yes, that gives you an awful lot of detail, and that'd be nice to do a few constellations on their own, really, with a little tracker. But yeah.
It's really something special, isn't it, that image? It's certainly very popular. I know that for a fact.
It shows off our skies, doesn't it, to their best, you know. And it's a great sight. And as you know, I mean, for me, it's, 10, 15 minutes up the road. And that's just a little area of a beautifully dark sight. Fortunately, there's no real lighting around there for, a good 5 or 6 miles.
Yeah, it's gorgeous there, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, if you want completely dark skies, I mean, I was very lucky last year and had 2 weeks in New Zealand, in the South Island, and it was amazing. All I could take was this and a tripod.
I remember you showing me, you posting a photo on social media, just popping outside the motel and taking...
Yes, the Billion Star Motel. Yes, I did. Yes, I'll have to pass that one on to you because, yeah, I mean, I came back at 4 a.m. And the town there, what's the name of the town? I can't remember the name of it now, but it's very well known. They've got an observatory there. It's a dark site area. They'll come to me once we're talking. But I went out frantically the whole night. It was a bit murky, and it got clearer as the night went on. And as I got back to our little apartment, now they're lit, but the lighting is so well thought out because the New Zealanders, you know they've got a good site there, and they have tourism for astronomy. So they keep the lights pointing down. And I just looked up and saw this amazing Milky Way above a lit village because all the lights were pointing down. I took a picture, and you can see our apartment well lit, but with not a hint of light pollution in the sky. So it's phenomenal place.
And so one of the things when you went to New Zealand, it gave you the opportunity to get the Milky Way from the Southern Hemisphere.
Yeah.
And when you came back to the UK, you did something quite interesting with it, didn't you?
Yeah, I had, since I started doing the skies, as we were talking earlier, and trying to get the best skies and all the rest of it, and start doing panoramics and seeing, thinking, what's the whole northern half of the Milky Way from the Northern Hemisphere? But it cuts off when you get to the centre of the galaxy because of the horizon. So obviously New Zealand is almost just about the complete opposite part of the world. So you're seeing the whole other side of the galaxy. So going there gave me the opportunity to do another big old panoramic of the whole southern half. And I always had this idea. I had this idea when I started doing this. Well, wouldn't that be good to get a whole lot of it, you know, and put it all together, north and south? I never thought no more of it, but of course, once we got back from New Zealand, when most like normal people think, well, I'll sleep off now and go to bed, I was up there putting them all together and trying to sort of, you know, manually put the two halves together to represent the Milky Way as it is shown or as it would look around our globe, because we're within the Milky Way, so it obviously encircles our globe. And that's the final result of what it was. So what you've got like the northern part of the Milky Way, the whole sort of northern half, which I've done from Cornwall.
Yeah.
And then obviously it then goes round to this side, which is from the southern half, which is from New Zealand, the complete opposite part of the world.
The better part of the Milky Way for us photographers.
It's a beautiful part, absolutely beautiful part to see that southern skies, because this is of great interest. The central part, as you can see, is like most light and all the details. But you know, you've got other gems. You've got the Carina Nebula, which is the biggest sort of visible nebula throughout the world. And these draw you like a magnet. They're called the Magellanic Clouds. As you know, you've got the large and small Magellanic Clouds, which are satellite galaxies. But to bring that into perspective, down here, there's a tiny little smudge there, which is Andromeda, our nearest neighbour galaxy, which we see from our part of the world. Well, over on this part of the world, you can see the difference in the size, and that's not because they're bigger, that's because they're a lot closer to us. So it shows you a lot of, well, the whole thing to scale. And I remember when I first put all this together, I was so excited. It was about 5 o'clock in the morning, and me being me, I went running in to tell my wife, who was sound asleep, "Oh, I've done it." But she wasn't as excited as me, so she told me what to do with it. But yeah.
And all of this captured with your Canon 16. I mean, I know there's loads of new... I mean, people love the Sony A7s and everything, but you're quite happily carrying on with your 16.
Yeah, I'm a stick in the mud, but I like to get the best out of it. And I like, you know, essentially, I suppose I like the single shot and to see what I can get with it, really. But that's given me the opportunity to do that, you know, the whole thing. And it's such a good chip. Might not be the latest thing, but it's such a good chip. It's so very sensitive to different stuff. And the pixels are quite big, giving a lot of sensitivity and all the rest of it. So I'm going to stick with this for a while.
Yeah. I was going to say, because one of the, I suppose, with the thing is with new cameras coming out, that means there's more 60s on the market that are second-handed.
Absolutely.
And for people who have a budget, the 60, would you feel, would be a good starter and a good full-frame beginner's camera?
Exactly. I mean, if you want to go into full-frame, that is probably still, I think, the cheapest way you can do it as well. I can't remember what I got this for, but that was under £1,000. Yeah. That's still a lot of money. But this is a full-frame, you know, almost professional camera we're talking about. And yes, you would find them second-hand probably a wee bit cheaper than that possibly now. And they're built like a tank, and they'll do you well. They'll last, you know. And They're not too sophisticated. They're very good for nighttime, if you, especially if you're cutting your teeth on it and you're learning.
Yeah.
Because the good thing I like about this is because I mainly do night stuff. I'm mostly in manual mode. So that's quite a simple camera. There's not too many gizmos on it to have to do this or that. You can set a few settings within 5 minutes and you're ready to go.
Yeah. So it's definitely still a worthwhile camera.
Oh, absolutely.
2019.
Absolutely, definitely. I would say to anyone, you won't go wrong.
Fantastic. Yeah. Sean, thanks very much.
You're welcome.
Thanks for that. Well, we've got to see a lot of Sean's photos and some amazing stuff there. So definitely check out the links in the description and go to Sean's website. And if you really like these images, you can buy them from his website. Check it out.